Okay, that's good.
Well, you're about to step on that thing. When we have a tour, the first thing we do is invite our guests in to be seated here, and then we have an 8-minute introductory video which describes some of the background of this place. Okay. Then, after the video, I give a little description of this building and this room. This building may have been built about 1880. That was the time when my grandmother and grandfather came to this location. They were newly married at that time. And it is possible that this building was built then. Actually, it was built as an addition to the previous residence, which is where the big house is now. And then in 1900, the previous residence was destroyed. The present residence was built, and these two rooms were moved over here and served various purposes since 1900. This building was underwent a major modernization about 15 years ago, and most of it was rebuilt, but some is original. For example, this window is the only window that was in the original building, and you'll notice that it has little pegs rather than sash cord. The doors are also part of the original building. Both the outside door and this door between the two rooms. We have some pictures here. I usually start with this picture and play a little game and see who can identify the location. The location actually is the city of Rome, and the Dome of St. Peter's is quite visible there. The other major building to the right is what is the Romans now call it Castel Sant'Angelo, because it has a statue of an angel on top of it. It actually began as the tomb of the Emperor Hadrian. The bridge in the picture was also an ancient bridge. It was built, let's see. The bridge is the Ponte Sant'Angelo, built by the Emperor Hadrian in AD 136. We also have one, two, three pictures by the artist Utrillo. He mostly painted pictures of Paris, and these two are probably Paris, and the one over here says in its fine print that it is the square of Montmartre. Montmartre is a well-known Parisian landmark. It looks like it's a winter scene with snow on the ground. Okay, now we'll go on to the next room. right, in this room we have a number of collections. One collection is this display of 100 coins from 100 lands. That is a part of a substantial collection of foreign coins. Some of the coins were probably brought by my father and my aunt in the 1920s. Others were acquired various other places.
All right, let me kind of pan this.
Some of the coins look a little different from the ones one... They're different from American coins. For instance, this one has a hole in it. And... some of them have a scalloped edge.
There's another with a hole in it.
There's another one with, this is one with a scalloped edge.
25 has a hole.
Some of them, like this one, are composed of two different metals. And an occasional one like this one is square rather than round.
Oh, it is square. Okay.
The mantle is part of the original building. And it does have a workable fireplace, though the chimney was largely rebuilt as it was in very poor condition. Over here we have a little Buddhist exhibit with a statue of Buddha, which improbably was obtained in Puerto Rico some years ago. And a leaf from a tree in Ceylon that is supposed to be a daughter tree of the tree under which the Buddha sat when he became enlightened. There are a number of coins here from Thailand and a couple of vases from Thailand. These are a number of buttons. My mother was a button collector, and that's part of her button collection. And there's a collection of shells here of various kinds. Come from various places. And a skull of a deer that was found very near here in the woods. The deer probably died as late as 2013 or 2014. And now we'll go on to the next hall.
You wanna, let me look at these coins here.
Oh, well.
On the wall.
The most recent coin display is this one here, which has been up only a few days. There are some 15 coins that are date from before 1900, as well as some others that date from 1900 to 1950.
And then there's a quite a collection over here on this wall from 140 countries?
Yes, actually I think now our number of countries is getting up nearly to 150.
Okay.
Okay, now we'll go on to the next room. Okay. There's a collection of old typewriters. The most interesting is my father's typewriter. It had the interesting capability of typing in both Greek and English. Now we have a bunch of pictures of Rome. This little hall contains a lot of pictures and some books relating to Rome. The black and white pictures I brought from Italy in 1955. That's when I came back after service in the Navy, which involved a residence in Italy for about a year. There are also
I'm getting a horrible reflection on that one. There you go.
Some colored pictures. This is a nice colored picture showing the baths of Caracalla.
And we're seeing this beautiful...
The baths of Caracalla date from long ago. The Emperor Caracalla was in power from 211 to 217 A.D.
Start over.
We've got a bunch of books relating to Rome. Caesar's Gallic Wars. The famous introductory line of that is, all Gaul was divided into three parts. And Caesar goes on to describe the three parts and how he went about conquering Gaul. Then we have a book of Cicero called the Tusculan Disputations. We have both the Latin version and the English version. Cicero was one of the most widely read Roman authors, and his works have been studied by schoolboys for a couple of thousand years. Then we have a book by Seneca. And Seneca's was a philosopher and a protege of the Emperor Nero. However, serving a tyrant is a dangerous occupation, and eventually Nero got tired of Seneca and ordered him to commit suicide. The book is sort of interesting because the editor of the English version and the editor of the Latin version do not divide the chapters the same way. The ancient books generally do not have, they do not come with divisions into chapters and verses, and it is up to some editor to make such a division. And that is also true of the Bible, which didn't get divided into chapters and verses for some hundred years. And finally, we have a book by Aulus Gellius with both the Latin version and the English version. And Aulus Gellius is not considered a very serious author, though a number of his little short stories have provided information not available elsewhere. One of them describes a dialogue between Socrates and the young man named Alcibiades. And Alcibiades asks Socrates why he puts up with his ill-tempered wife. And Socrates replies, well, it gives me practice in dealing with young whippersnappers like you. Now we'll go on to the next room. This is a collection of pictures that my grandmother Johnson collected. She lived from 1861 to 1948 and was interested in various things. We also have a spoon collection over here. I don't know where most of the spoons came from, but the last three were brought from Romania in 2014. There are some pictures here. The one over there is perhaps the most interesting. That was obtained by my father probably in the 1950s. And my guess is he bought it in a Chicago junk shop for $5.
And there's a story behind it?
There's probably a story behind it, but you can make that up for yourself.
Oh, okay. Anything else in here?
And we have a number of pictures. After the Roman period came the medieval period, and this is an example of medieval art. This is the Empress Theodora, and it is a mosaic in the church in Ravenna in Italy. The church was built prior to 547 AD. Theodora had an interesting career. She began as a dancing girl and caught the emperor's eye, and her fortunes improved greatly after that. Then we have this, a more conventional medieval art. This is the Virgin Mary with a child, and this is the altarpiece of the church in Florence, Italy, and by the artist Duccio di Buoninsegna. Duccio lived approximately 1250 to 1358, to 1318. And this is a picture of a manuscript, a French manuscript. it tells the story of Oedipus, and when Oedipus was born, the soothsayer said he would grow up to murder his father and marry his mother, and they thought that was a terrible thing, so they sent him out to a woodcutter to be exposed and die. But the woodcutter was warm-hearted and preserved the boy. He did grow up and he did return to his father's home and murder his father and marry his mother. This is a fragment of medieval manuscript Unlike a number of things, we believe this is a genuine medieval manuscript. It turns out to be a calendar of April and May, and with the names of saints. For each day there is a saint. And that's the way they did things in the medieval period. Often a child would be named for the saint on whose day he or she was born. Okay, stop.
Go ahead and go.
Now we're going upstairs. Oh, okay. Now this is the Bryant Room. We call it that because of the possibility that William Jennings Bryan spent a night here in the early 1900s. And we have several collections here. There is a collection of American coins, including a dozen or so different dollar coins. And a little collection of kerosene lamps. And this is a military uniform. This one was the uniform of Tom Johnson during his naval career from approximately 1952 to 55. This was a uniform used by Robert Johnson. He served in the Army approximately 1947 to 48. And then over here we have the note that William Jennings Bryan left when he had a dinner here in 1902.
I got a reflection on it.
Which was reported on in the local paper.
I got a reflection on that. I don't know if it's going to work or not. Let's see.
Now, this bed is believed to have come from a hotel in Chicago known as the Palmer House, which was replacing its furniture probably around the 1950s or 60s. And my father probably bought this bed when it was being discarded.
And what about this small one over here? That's interesting.
It's what?
What about this small one here? That's interesting.
Oh, the small bed, believed to have been used by Aunt Helen, my aunt, who was a small person. And it was also my childhood bed at one time.
Okay, now where are we
now
going?
Now we go on to the next room.
Okay, go.
We call this the portrait room. And there are a number of portraits, large life-size portraits, most of which are believed to have been collected by my father, Franklin Johnson, probably from Chicago junk shops in the 1950s or 60s. One of them, we do know the artist. It was a artist known as C.P.A. Healy. And his name can be observed up in the upper left-hand corner of the painting. We do not know who the subject of the painting is. Another one, we believe we know who the subject is. It is probably Hamilton Fish, an American statesman who was Secretary of State under President Grant from 1869 to 1877. We do not know who the artist was in that case. In the other cases, and for the other pictures, we do not know either the artist or the subject, though this one we have identified other pictures which seem to put the likely time of the picture is about the mid-1850s, and the same is true of this portrait of a lady, and we have located a picture which shows a similar portrait with similar hairstyle and neckline and pin. And one of my visitors decided that the pin really contains a portrait of Christ wearing a crown of thorns, which may or may not be accurate. Now we'll go on from here. Now, have you ever been out this door?
No. He has a trap door. Oh, we go outside.
I've got to go around and open that door from the inside up there.
Oh my goodness. And we look over to the side. There's a walkway over to the two doors, the two rooms. And there it is, the two rooms. And it's connected through the walkway that we just came through earlier. This provides a nice little balcony here, screened in upper level area. Okay.
Well, we got the bird out.
Did we? You sure? Yes. Did you see him go?
Yeah, I was up there and...
Okay. And he left?
This balcony was built in recent years. And
look at the
sort of a nice view of the
look at the view.
In the winter when the leaves are off the trees, you can see a good deal more.
Okay.
And this bar and lounge was built in recent years.
and the steps come up from inside.
And I'm glad to have somebody here who can see this flower, which has...
well, we'll just get that recorded.
which has done very
well. It certainly has.
So you may recognize this.
Yes.
That's the one
I so recognize.
which you kindly donated a few years ago. It seemed that for a while that it was almost dead, but now some of it, at any rate, is doing well.
Nice barn, nice mirror behind it.
And in this room, I call this the lounge. We have a rug which was brought from India a few years ago. And a fairly interesting collection of costume jewelry that was discovered recently.
Okay, getting a reflection. Okay, I got it now. Gotta figure out how to keep the reflections off of it.
And we also have a collection of pictures.
Love that table.
Oh, well. These pictures are sort of a miscellany. They are almost all old. Other than that, very little is known about their origin.
Okay. Yeah, let's look at the sewing machine table here. It still has thread in the drawers. An authentic... Oh, look at the bobbins.
Yeah.
There are bobbins there. And needles. Oh, well, why not? I'm going back downstairs.
Now we're going into the east parlor, where there are a number of family pictures. Notably, the pictures of my grandfather and grandmother. That was probably taken around the time of their wedding, which was in 1880. Some other pictures are here. including one of Waldo P. Johnson He was the United States Senator and the first family owner of the present property. He returned to Osceola after the Civil War. His previous house had been burned, and he bought this property in 1870. This is a Joseph Johnson, who was a governor of Virginia in the 1850s. He was a uncle of Waldo P. Johnson. And over here is Aunt Helen. This is a fairly glamorous picture of Aunt Helen. When I knew her, she was in her 70s. It didn't look quite so glamorous. She was a student of Sanskrit and spent several years in India, working on a translation of a book by the sage Hemachandra. And this is this was a farewell gift when Aunt Helen left India for the last time. Her co-workers gave her this certificate of appreciation. We have a couple of other interesting pictures here. For instance, this is a picture of Istanbul in Turkey, and an enlarged postcard which shows how it really looks today. Moving now into the river parlor. And this is an attractive little piece of furniture donated by our good friend Elaine Johnson.
And there she is. Brief glimpse. It's actually a lantern holder. Coal, you know, one of these coal oil lanterns holders.
Oh, the lantern fit in there?
Mm-hmm.
Well, very good.
Okay.
The light here has stopped functioning, as you may notice.
Yeah.
And I need to get somebody to fix that. My usual workman has been ill lately.
Go, go.
This is a replica of the first page of the Gutenberg Bible. The Gutenberg Bible is often considered to be the first modern printed book. And it was printed about 1450. The language is Latin and not too easy to figure out. For example, it starts out, "Incipit liber Bressus," which first puzzled me for a while until I figured out that Bereshith is really the Hebrew word for Genesis. So it means the beginning of the book Bereshith, which we call Genesis. And then in the beginning, in principio, creavit Deus caelu et terram. In the beginning created God heaven and earth. And this is a replica of a sheet from a German Bible. And the little game we play here, it's clear that this is from chapter 32. And the first line says, but the sons of Reuben and the sons of Gad possessed a great quantity of cattle. And I always try to ask my visitors if they can tell me which book of the Bible that comes from. And very rarely can anybody correctly identify it.
I did.
It actually is from the book of Numbers. Though the story, as it goes on, is not terribly enlightening, because they say they have a large quantity of cattle and they look around for some land to steal so they can pasture their cattle. And this is a page from a book we actually have. This is let's see who this is. Pico della Mirandola. And he was a Italian humanist in the late 1400s. And this is one of the early printed books. Pico's interesting idea was that humankind was worthy of dignity and respect, which was something of a new idea at the time of the Renaissance. Because during the medieval period, the received doctrine had been that human life didn't amount to much. It was only the heavens and the heavenly afterlife that was important. This is another page from a book that we have. This is a book by Plotinus. Plotinus lived AD 205 to 270. He was a Neoplatonic philosopher, and he had some ideas that were unusual for his time. For example, the title here, Tertius Liber, that's the third book, Utrum stellae liquid agant, which means approximately whether the stars have any effect. And then, as now, astrology was popular, but Plotinus was unusual in coming to the conclusion that they really didn't have much effect. And this is an exhibit of several old and interesting books. This one, for example, is unusual since it's handwritten. This one appears to be a first edition of a book on philosophy by the German philosopher Hegel. And this one is the Spectator paper from MDCCLIII, 1500 plus 200 makes 1753. Now we're going on to the next room. This is interesting. That's a panoramic view of the old city of Jerusalem. And the distinctive landmark there is the gold dome of the Dome of the Rock. And this is a Islamic saying. The first line says, "In the name of God, the merciful, the compassionate." And the second line says, "There is no deity but God, and Muhammad is his messenger." Yeah, we're now going into the building we call the Annex, which contains sort of the overflow of books from the original library, plus a number of more recent additions, including, for example, a substantial number of encyclopedias. It also contains a number of law books from Tom Johnson's legal career and a substantial number of economics books from his period as a teacher of college courses in economics. We continue to acquire things of interest. Here, for example, is a map of Romania. It's dated 1808, and that is a replica of the original, and that was obtained in Romania in 2014. And those are several pictures, three pictures of Franklin P. Johnson. The top picture shows him wearing a garment known in the family as the Uncle Charlie dress, in which numerous infants were photographed.
Okay.
Now we're going to a short hall which leads to the original library. There are several pictures from Italy here. To the left are three pictures from Florence, and to the right are three pictures from Venice.
This is Florence. And this is Venice. This is a beautiful stained glass window in between. Okay.
Now we're going upstairs to the upper floor of the library. There is a place to plug in over here.
And my cord is downstairs. Should I go get it? Well, let's see what we can do. Go ahead. Go for it.
This table contains a number of books. On this side are 6 books of philosophy, and on the other side are 6 books of in foreign languages. Some of the philosophy books are quite interesting. This one, for example, contains a recipe for how to turn lead into gold. Success is not guaranteed. There are a couple of interesting pictures of the Solomon's Temple, at least how modern scholars and painters think it might have looked. Also in this room we have pictures of philosophers. There is Hegel and there is Berkeley and Plato and... Let's see, we've got a couple of others. This is Epictetus, and finally, Pythagoras. My grandfather was greatly interested in the philosophy of Plato, and he published a little magazine called The Platonist. Didn't quite sell all the ones that were printed, so we've got a number left. For example, this is the number for April 1887. Then in this other room, we have one book that I show to visitors. It's a book by Marsilius Ficinus. And one interesting thing there is the date. The real old books don't have a title page, but they often have a date at the end. For example, this one has a date in Roman numerals, but nowadays many younger folks aren't familiar with Roman numerals. But a little ingenuity reveals that it's the 16th of September from the year 14 1489.
Wow.
Another thing that visitors often find interesting is the small books we have. For example, this is a Bible that is almost microscopic in the size of its print.
Yeah, I can't zoom to read that.
The
book is the size of your thumbs.
Another one that's even smaller. It comes with its own magnifying glass.
Oh my goodness, look at that.
But even with the magnifying glass, it's a little hard to read.
Pages are bigger than your thumbs. And then look at the shelf right above that. Those small books.
This is a little set they're of Shakespeare's plays.
Tiny, but they're small.
And my guess is that these were used by actors. You could hold it in your hand and read your lines if you'd forgotten them. Mm-hmm. This table contains a collection of 8 Bibles. The interesting thing that they're all sort of oriented toward is the last chapter of the book of Mark, because this chapter is a little difficult to figure out, and various editors have treated it in different ways. And everybody can read it and make up their own mind as to how to treat it.
What's this? What's that?
Okay. This case contains a number of books that were given to my father when he was a child. And many of them have a book played in. This one was given to him in 1905, October 4th of 1905. And it contains the motto, which has been adopted by the Johnson Library and Museum, Sapientia non potest vinci, which can be translated, Wisdom cannot be conquered. Okay, going now downstairs. I've got another flower that was in bloom. This one's about done blooming, but you can see.
Cactus, isn't it?
Yeah. That was one of my mother's plants. She's been gone for 30 years, but her plants live on. Well, okay, you can plug in over here if you want.
Okay. Okay,
go. This room was originally the bedroom of my grandfather. The last 20 years or so of his life, he lived in this building. And went over to the other building for his meals, but he stayed in this building most of the time, and this was his bedroom. Now it contains a number of our older books, as well as some newer encyclopedias. This case has mostly philosophy books in it. The pictures are sort of a miniature Italian art exhibit. Several of the pictures were in the building originally, and others were brought from Italy. Over here, mostly these are books about religion. My grandfather did not belong to any Christian church, though he has been quoted as saying that if there was a Unitarian church in Osceola, he might have joined it. This case contains a number of books that are both old and big, and many of them have been regarded with great interest by Professor Dave Richards from Missouri State University. Now we'll go on to the next room. The used as a study for by my grandfather, and there's a picture showing him in this room in probably in the early 1900s, and a lot of the furniture in the picture can still be identified in the room. These are a couple of interesting objects. This one is a Minoan dagger, a replica, and these are replicas of gold cups that were believed to date from 1500 BC. We have here are a number of old books on display, and also an old The Times of London from 1817. And a few other books over here. For instance, this is an early Godey's Ladies book from, this has the date in it, 1837. And this is a little exhibit from India. This is a volume of the book translated by Aunt Helen. The title is Trisasti Shalaka Purusha Charita, which means the lives of 63 illustrious persons. And several pictures showing scenes in India. Some are genuine and some are mythological. And a recently displayed exhibit of old coins from India. Probably most of those were brought back by Aunt Helen.
Just a minute. No, wait. Turn it back on. I didn't get that. There you go.
Not all the actions in India were gentle. This picture shows how convicts were executed in India. And that's about all we have. We do have our latest copy of our journal here, and everybody is invited to take one.
And does that conclude our tour?
That completes our tour.
Okay, we'll call that done.
Let me turn off. We have constructed walkways to connect the three buildings here, actually four buildings, and that enable us to go on a tour completely inside, which is be very handy if the weather is very hot or very cold.
Or rainy. We're now outside, and on the left you can see the edge of the two rooms. And this area that we're looking at now is the walkway constructed over the driveway. And then as we move on to the main residence, we can see the outside walkway that goes up to the upper bar and lounge, right?
Right.
Yeah. And then there's the front. We're looking at the west side of the house now. The upstairs. Three levels.
By the way, you know anything about peach trees?
And there is a walkway through, connecting this building, and there's a walkway through connecting it to the final building, the main library. Beautiful stained glass windows here and there. And here we have Tom and his peach tree.